Hello, my dear students. This is Brijesh Kumar. I am going to teach you confessional poetry today. Confessional poetry is a style of poetry, dear students, that emerged and evolved in the United States of America during the decades of 1950s and 1960s. It is a type of narrative and lyric poetry which usually deals with the facts and intimate mental and physical experiences of the poet's own life. Dear students, what a narrative poetry is that you need to know. Narrative poetry is a form of poetry which usually is narrated by the speaker or by the poet, and it is not meant for performance by the actors on the stage. So, confessional poetry is a type of narrative poetry which is meant for narration. Plus, it is lyrical poetry. What does a lyric mean? That you also need to see here. A lyric is a short subjective poem which usually expresses a certain state of mind of the poet. So, confessional poems, they also express some certain sort of state of mind of the poet himself or herself. So, here you have seen the meaning of the narrative poetry as well as the meaning of the lyric poetry. So again, let's see, it's a type of narrative and lyric poetry which deals with the facts and intimate mental and physical experiences of the poet's own life. Dear students, this sort of poetry deals with the intimate mental and physical experiences which a poet usually undergoes throughout her or his own life. Dear students, the next point is, it has been popularized by Robert Lowell, who has given a highly personal accounts of his life and familial ties in his poetry collection, Life Studies, that he published in 1959, which had significant impact on many other poets of this mode of writing, such as Sylvia Plath, John Perryman, Anne Sexton, Allen Ginsberg during the decades of the 1950s and 1960s. My dear students, this particular form in the United States of America had been initiated by Robert Lowell, who himself has written a very popular poetry collection with the title Life Studies, which he published in 1959. And in this particular poetry collection, in most of the poems, he has given a highly personal account of his own life and familial ties with people, with society, as well as with individuals, which usually had a great impact on the writers of the subsequent years. Or many of the contemporary writers were also influenced by this particular mode of writing, and many of them followed Robert Lowell's way of writing. And some of them who have become in literature very popular, they are Sylvia Plath, John Barryman, Anne Sexton, Allen Ginsberg, and many more. Dear students, you must not forget that Robert Lowell was a university professor who taught in University of Iowa, and after that he shifted to Boston University, and then he taught in University of Cincinnati, Yale University, and after that he moved to Harvard University. And many of the famous writers of this particular genre of subgenre of poetry, like Anne Sexton and Sylvia Plath, they were his university students. And then the next point, dear students, it talks about poet's sexual experiences, his her personal as well as private relationships, mental angst, traumas and illnesses, experiments with drugs and suicidal impulses, which are often set in relation to broader social themes. My dear students, a confessional poet talks about his or her own sexual experiences. He or she also talks about his or her personal relationships as well as private relationships, which usually a normal poet does not talk about. Then moving on, you will find that a confessional poet talks about his or her mental angst, traumas and illnesses which he or she has undergone over a long period of time in his life. Then experiments with drugs and suicidal impulses, he or she also talks about. What does that mean? experiments with drugs. Many of the writers of this particular mode of poetry were influenced by the postmodernist writers because they were writing in postmodern age. And postmodernist writers, they were very much experimentative in their craft as well as in their personal lives. So these writers who were writing confessional poetry also have some certain tendencies of the postmodernist writers. They have experimented with drugs. They were the people who were in the habit of taking liquor or wine, having drugs in order to intoxicate themselves. And such kind of experiences of intoxication, they have recorded in many of their poems, as well as they also have recorded suicidal impulses. What does that mean? At times, you will find that such a person is a kind of person which is usually not accepted by the society. So, a poet who writes in this mode of, poetry often finds himself or herself rejected or dejected by the society. And he or she feels during, this period of time, feel the thoughts of suicides. And many of them, they try also to commit suicide. For example, Sylvia Plath tried twice to commit suicide. And such kind of, if they remain alive, even after their trial of, remember the trial of suicide in some of them, when they feel these kinds of thoughts, all these kind of suicidal thoughts, they record in their poems, in which usually are often said in relation to broader social themes. And such kind of experiences, which are personal in nature, which are very much individualistic, you will find that they are related to the broader social themes, because in poem, you can find that this is the experience of a single person or a single individual, but to a great extent, you will find that those, writers, they raise the voices of so many people in the society who is, because of one reason or another reason, do not have sufficient courage to express themselves. So, you can well see how these themes can be well related to broader social themes. Then the next point, to a great extent, this sort of poetry is subjective, which talks about I, me, and my of the poet against the demand for impersonality theory by T.S. Eliot and the new critics who speak for autotelic text. Dear students, when you kind of analyze the poems of a confessional poet, you will find that he or she writes in subjective mode, not in objective mode, and therefore, it is against the impersonality theory of T.S. Eliot, which he has incorporated in his very famous and celebrated essay, Tradition in Individual Talent, where he asserts that the personality of the poet must not be reflected in his or her poems at any rate. But in the poems of, confessional poets, you will find that they express their personality to a great extent. And then the next thing is new critics. There were a group of critics who emerged in United States of America itself, and who to a great extent talk about autotelic text, who also assert that the poet or the writer's biography is not necessary in order to analyze the text to which he or she has written. So in this, we will find that these two theories, new criticism as well as impersonality theory of T.S. Eliot, both are against the confessional mode of poetry. And then the next point, dear student, it is very much unlike the religious confessions of saints, like that of Saint Augustine, because of the absence of the feelings of regret or personal experiences. Dear students, here you will find that a confessional poet does not write in the way a saint writes his confessions. Because you will find that when a saint writes his confessions in the form of a book, he usually has a feeling of regret. He always regrets what he has done in his life. But here you will find a confessional poet does not regret what he or she has done. So in this way, a confessional poetry is different from a normal religious confession, which usually people do in front of the a statue of Jesus Christ maybe, or any saint records in the form of a book. And then the next thing, feelings of romantic poets such as William Wordsworth and Coleridge, who talk more about how nature has influenced their life and lives around them. Students, you can well find here how the poetry of romantic poets is different from the poetry of confessional poets, because both of them, they kind of express their ideas, but one expresses, one group of poets expresses their ideas about personal relationships, about sexual relationships, about private relationships, about so many kind of experiments with drugs, etc. And they are known as confessional poets. And another group of poets who are known as romantic poets, they express how they relate themselves to nature, how they relate themselves to the people around nature, and what kind of relationship they themselves have established with nature. And thus, both of them, they express their ideas, but in two different directions. Then the next point, dear student, confessional poets have not only recorded their emotions on paper, but they have also maintained a high level of poetic craftsmanship through their careful attention to the use of prosody. Dear students, it can well notice that the confessional poets have not only recorded what they feel from inside their heart on paper, they have not only recorded their experiences, their feelings on paper, but they also have maintained a high level of poetic craftsmanship through their careful attention to the use of prosody. That means they know it very well how a poem should be written. They were very much adept, they were very expert in the field of poetry writing, and they have followed the rules of poetry, and that's why they have caught the attention of a large group of public who have read them, who have either criticized them or praised them for their, not only expression of emotions, but for their, craftsmanship of poetry. And then the last one is Kamaladas is a major Indian confessional poetess who has written many poems in this mode. For example, An Introduction, A Heart Known at Malabar, My Grandmother's House, Eunuch, and many more. And dear students, for the sake of concretizing your knowledge, your understanding of what a confessional poetry is, I am going to recite with a little analysis of one of the poems of Kamaladas, and the title of this poem is An Introduction. Dear student, here is the poem, An Introduction by Kamaladas. The poem starts like this. I don't know politics, but I know the names of those in power and can repeat them like days of week or names of months, beginning with Nehru. I'm Indian, very brown, born in Malabar. I speak three languages, write in two, dream in one. And when she speaks all these things, she seems to be very happy. Until people around him, they come and complain that what she is doing is not good. And then, you see, the lines ahead, don't write in English. They said, English is not your mother tongue. People who are there around her, they come and tell to her that English is not her mother tongue. Rather, she must write in Malayalam. And because of this reason, she is ridiculed by those people of the society, those relatives, cousins, friends, everyone who come to her to complain about the sort of poetry she is writing. But what she says, you see, don't write in English. They said, English is not your mother tongue. And then she says, "Why not leave me alone, critics, friends, visiting cousins, every one of you? Why not let me speak in any language I like? The language I speak becomes mine. Its distortions, its queerness is all mine, mine alone." She says that the language which she uses for writing her poetry becomes her own. Everything of this language becomes her own. And so there is no point of her being ridiculed by those people who always come complaining to her about the language which she uses for writing her poetry. It is half English, half Indian, funny perhaps, but it is honest. She says that it may be kind of chutneyfication of Rusty, remember? Maybe half English, half Indian, sometimes it seems funny, but whatever she wants to express here is this, that it is very much honest. It is as human as I am human, don't you see? It voices my joys, my longings, my hopes, and it is useful to me as cowing is to crows or roaring to the lions. It is human speech, the speech of the mind, and that is here and not there, a mind that sees and hears and is aware. She says that this language naturally comes to her as crows, cowing to crows or roaring to the lions. These kind of sounds are very much natural to this particular bird, crow, as well as to lion. Similarly, the language which she uses is very much natural to her. It is the speech of the mind of the people. It is not something which people cannot understand. They cannot, well get it. It is not something which is usually used by the romantic writers, I told you. And here he makes a kind of difference between what a romantic poet thinks and how a romantic poet thinks and what and how a confessional poet thinks. She says that it's not the language of the trees or the language of the monsoon or the language of the storm or clouds or rain or anything which those romantic poets, they claim that they can understand, and which many of the common people, they cannot understand. But she says that the language which she uses can be understood by anyone. It's the language of the common speech. It's the language of the people around her in the society. And then she tells us about her sexual experiences, her personal and private relationships in the lines ahead. And she says, "I was a child. And later they told me I grew, for I became tall, my limbs swelled in one or two places, sprouted hair. When I asked for love, not knowing what else to ask, for he drew a youth of 16 into the bedroom and closed the door. He did not beat me, but my sad woman body felt so beaten. The weight of my breasts in home crushed me. I shrank pitifully. Then I overassert my brother's trousers. Cut my hair short and ignored my womanliness. And after that, the people of the society, they also have come ahead to ridicule this girl, telling, dress in sari, be girl, be wife, they said, be embroiderer, be cook, be a quarreler with the servants, fit in, oh, belong, cried the categorizers, don't sit on walls or peep in through our lace-draped windows, be Ami or be Kamla or waiter, still be Madhva Kutti, it's a time to choose a name, a role, don't place pretending games, don't play at schizophrenia or be a nympho, don't cry embarrassingly loud when jilted in love." Here, dear students, you can well find how she starts telling us, expressing her experiences of those people who have come one by one in her life, and how many of them they have exploited her mentally, physically, in each and every way. Moreover, the people of the society, they have come to her to tell that she must try to accommodate her according to the rules and laws of the society. She must not behave as if she is schizophrenia or as if she is a victim of schizophrenia or she is a kind of mad girl. Rather, she must behave as every single woman of the society she behaves. And then further she says, I met a man, loved him, call him not by any name, he's every man who wants a woman, just as I'm every woman who seeks love. And very candidly, she accepts this here in these lines, that she is a normal woman and she's like a man who wants love in relationships, and similarly she's a woman who also wants love in affection, in care, in relationships. In him, the hungry haste of freebirds; in me, the ocean's tireless waiting. Who are you? I ask each and every one. The answer is, it is I. Anywhere and everywhere, I see the one who calls himself I. In this word, he is tightly packed like the sword in its sheath. It is I who drink lonely drinks at 12 midnight in hotels of strange towns. It is I who laugh. It is I who make love and then feel shame. It is I who lie dying with a rattle in my throat. And here, again, dear students can well understand how she very frankly accepts the experiences which she herself has undergone over a long time frame. You see how she says that it is I who drink lonely. Here she talks about her drinking, which usually in our society, in India, we people think that women should not drink. A woman who drinks is not supposed to be a good woman in the society. But she said that she drinks, and she drinks not only in the day, but drinks at 12, midnight, in hotels of strange towns, everywhere. It is I who laugh, it is I who make love and then feel shame. It is I who lie dying with a rattle in my throat. These kind of experiences she is kind of expressing here. I am sinner, I am saint, I am the beloved and the betrayed. I have no joys that are not yours, no aches which are not yours. I too call myself very much like men who usually call themselves I. She says that she also calls herself I because she also has enjoyed her life, you know, in its extremity. And that's the thing she expresses here. And in this way, dear students, you can well find how a confessional poet like Kamala Das has expressed in this very poem the experiences, the feelings, the mental angst, and different kinds of other, you know, experiences which she has felt at one time or another in her life in this very poem. Dear students, this lecture ends here. If you have found this lecture fruitful, please like the video. Thank you very much.